During my third year of freelancing, I unexpectedly owed the government $13,000 because I fucked up my self-employed tax payments. Don't be like me. Here's some advice. Hey, I'm Carrie. Welcome back to my channel, or welcome for the first time. All around, welcome. I'm carrieblogger, a career freelancer on Fiverr.com, where I've been selling as a Fiverr Pro Verified copywriter for about the past 8 years. And in today's Freelance Friday video, we are talking about freelance taxes, my friends. Oh boy, healthcare, pensions, taxes, all the things that make freelancing like just this much less cool. Maybe you don't mind tax season. I personally don't mind paying taxes. I think we should have taxes for the good of what it can do. Like, we're not getting into that. But I hate tax season. I hate how confusing it is. I always feel like an absolute idiot. I'm always worried I'm gonna do something wrong. And you know what? My fears are kind of founded because 1 year when I thought I was doing everything right, I was doing the payments. I was trying to follow my old tax preparer's advice. And I come up to April and she's writing down on her little sticky note how much money I'm supposed to owe that I underpaid. And I had to ask, is this a comma or is this a dot? This can't be right. There's no way that I owe $13,000 in April at once when I also owe my next quarter. And she said, yep, you messed up. April already sucks, and for freelancers, it's just so much worse. So here's the deal. As a self-employed person, if you are not familiar, assuming you're in the US, that's also what I'm talking about here, hence the accent, self-employed people have to pay 4 times a year, and these are our estimates so that we, I don't know why, but we have to do it. You pay on April 15th, July 15th, September 15th, and January 15th. I know this is like how the fiscal year works or whatever, but it always super confuses me because January is quarter four, not quarter one. I can't tell you how many times I've had to try to overwrite that thought in my head. And when you do send these payments to the state, if you have income tax, and the federal government, you are paying these with vouchers. And you can find these vouchers online. I personally get them from my tax preparer. And if they come from a tax preparer, they are printed with the number that you are supposedly going to pay 4 times a year, which is based on your last year's tax filing. This is the exact problem that I had when I fucked up like an actual idiot. Because I knew that I was earning more than I was the year before, but it's so variable, it's so flexible, and I was like, I don't know for sure. I don't know. I won't know till the end of the year how much money I make. And so I looked at the vouchers. They say they're printed with exactly how much I'm supposed to pay. And I'm like, okay. I messaged my old tax preparer and I said, hey, I think I'm making more money. I feel like I'm supposed to be paying more. And she said, just do what I said. It's fine. So I, thinking I'm being, you know, helpful to myself, I paid a little extra. I paid a couple hundred extra dollars. I paid, I think, $1,000 maybe extra on one of them just because I was like, I really don't think this is right. And at the end of the year, I just hoped I'd done enough because you don't know. We got to April. I'm not gonna recap the story. Massive surprise. The other issue is, as a freelancer, I said you have to pay 4 times a year, which means you're also paying in April for the first quarter of the next year, not just what you owed last year. So my absolute, cannot stress this enough, best advice is if you are not making dollar for dollar exactly what you did last year, do not trust whatever is printed on the vouchers. So instead, actually calculating the actual estimates is the way to go. What I personally have done, I got help. I totally recommend a tax consultant. For my husband and I, we paid $300 this year with a small tip to my tax preparer, and that covered everything. And I love her and she's amazing. And included in that is a spreadsheet that she prepares for me in Excel that automatically generates my estimates. And that is based on the class of income that we're in. It is based on my state taxes. I'm in Oregon, so we have income tax. It's based on the kinds of deductions that we typically take every year. And then as I put in my earnings year long, it tallies up by the quarter exactly what I have to pay based on what I actually earned. So for me, immensely valuable. And so for the past 3 years, I've ended up with a refund every single year, which I'm like, thank God. Because if I can do anything to make tax season less awful, I will do it. If that is the government telling me, you know what? You don't have to pay as much. We got you. You got you, you know. If you don't have an accountant that you love, there is a website that I found called Keeper Tax. If you go to keepertax.com/quarterlytaxcalculator, That's a helpful tool. Of course, it's not as nuanced as what I'm describing, and I don't think it would give me as much peace of mind. The peace of mind is really what I'm going for here. But using that as a tool to make your estimates more accurate and make you feel more secure that it's actually matching what you're earning over the course of the year rather than being like a salary figure that is a year divided by four, and that's really what the estimates on the vouchers are based off of, and that's not the reality of the situation. And now my amazing, lovely tax consultant took a second to write down three tips of what she recommends for the most important advice for freelancers, direct from Shasta. Number one, she says, don't just throw your business expenses into a folder to deal with at tax time, because if you're not using an actual spreadsheet or tax accounting software, you don't wanna have to pay your tax accountant hourly rates to go through a list of random things and file them individually into itemized deduction categories. I personally don't have a ton of expenses, which is good, but like also sucks for taxes because as a writer, I'm not buying tons of equipment. I'm not going on travel trips that I can expense. But little things that I do in my document, you can sort by your deductions category. Just do it as you're listing them throughout the year so that you're prepared for April. And sort it by things like professional expenses, inspiration media, office expenses, advertising. Those things, even by sorting in those four categories, you're already setting yourself up so much more for April when you need to figure out where the heck you put those numbers into your form. Number two is to understand the difference between personal and business expenses. I personally had to have this conversation with her because I was super confused. So if you use your cell phone, for example, for business and personal, I do, you can only deduct the portion that you actually use for your business. So when I first tried to do this, I was like, heck yeah, my AT&T bill is this much a month, take it off my taxes. But you can't do that. So if you only use your cell phone about 25% of the time for business and the other 75% is just for fun, you can only take off 25% of your bill. And I don't personally do anything with my car for business because, like I said, I'm a writer, so I'm not driving anywhere. This is really interesting to me, and I'm going to look at this because I will not remember. She said, in most cases, it is best to deduct an amount for business miles driven instead of deducting the actual cost of a car that you would use for business. We're gonna get into the nitty gritty here. Skip if you don't care. The 2021 IRS standard mileage rate is 56 cents per mile, so driving 10,000 business miles this year would get you a $5,600 deduction. On the other hand, if you purchased a $50,000 vehicle that you plan to use 50% for business, you could only deduct $25,000 over 5 years, which is $5,000 per year. And that wouldn't be able to deduct anything but 50% of repairs and maintenance for the rest of the life of the vehicle. Whereas, mileage deductions could be taken every year. Also, once you elect to deduct the cost of the vehicle, you can't ever switch to the mileage method in a later tax year for the same vehicle or vice versa. So make sure to do your homework up front. And that, my friends, is why you hire a tax accountant who is an expert in what they do, because I, probably you, would never know that. Some people on the internet who are more financially savvy than me, I'm sure, will suggest and have suggested to me that you should be underpaying your estimated taxes all year long. You should be investing that money. Get that coin. You're gonna maximize your wealth. And then with that, you will have earned more than the payment penalty that the government will charge you, and in the end, you will be better off. I think that's awful advice. I will not do that. If you wanna play that game, go for it. This is my tax tips video, god damn it. So I'm not gonna do that, and I'm not gonna suggest that you do either. What I will suggest is that you save. Some people who struggle with an actual budget and making sure that things end up with the right amounts where they're all supposed to be, actually save monthly to go towards the estimate so that they have a pool of money set aside just for that. We're naturally very strong savers. So when it comes time to pay my estimates, our pool of money is large enough that that is not an issue for us. But especially if you're not saving for those estimates, you get to the end of the year, you've been underpaying, you haven't been saving, and then you do find out that you do owe in April, that's really hard, really hard. Again, I'm so lucky that we did have the money pooled up that I could pay what was owed. But oh my God, we were not expecting that. So at the very least, save, which is such privileged advice to be saying, but if you can, and you should, save. That way, if and when something happens, you'll be okay. Hopefully that's helpful. It was mostly me rambling today and complaining, but hopefully that's helpful. Thank you for watching. Please be sure to like and subscribe if you enjoy my channel and check out the links below in the description, which help me out if you click on them. So I appreciate it. Good luck with your taxes. I wish you the very best. And let's get back to work.